let me say sorry for the delay in the presentation and thanks for waiting. Now, who merits a CR? So what is the focus of a selection procedure? It is based on the philosophy that evaluating prospective recipients is to ensure that there is potential for significant benefit not only from the device, that is the software. Not only from the copier and plan, that is the device, but also the procedure in that is the mapping, the surgery and therapy in terms of hearing. And the second, ensure that there is minimal chance of a reduction in the auditory ability. So what are the selection aims? To make realistic recommendations on potential benefits based on individual assessment, to carry out the process effectively and provide appropriate long-term management to maximize the outcomes, and to optimize the potential for implanted fragile to improve not only in speech perception and production, but also develop communication skills. Now the question arises, will the cochlear implant provide the child more of detection, comprehension, or expression? Other questions also are asked. Primary mean, can a CI provide more auditory information to the peripheral auditory system? What is the prognosis for meaningful use of the auditory information? And will a CI facilitate adequate communication and development outcomes using? So now to achieve our goals, we should have a multidisciplinary approach to the assessment of the candidacy, but the selection has to be done on a case-by-case basis. So who is part of the cochlear implant team? Obviously the recipient is the family, the surgeon, the audiologist, the speech pathologist, the teacher for the deaf, the counselor or the social worker or the psychologist, and other consulting professionals like radiologist, pediatrician, neuropediatrician, physiotherapist, occupational therapist as the need arises. We are now going to look at certain audiograms which are typical. These are the aided, unaided and aided findings. So also in the next slide. And this gives us our guidelines for initial reference, like who's suitable. Or in the audiograms you saw in the unaided ones that each had a bilateral severe to profound sensory neural hearing loss, either congenital or acquired, where the thresholds were more than 90 dB HL. The aided audiometric threshold also fell outside the speech range of the banana, which was more than 50 dB SPL. And there is insufficient audition to consistent hearing aid used to facilitate the development of functional speech and spoken language. Now this is just a aided audiogram to show what benefits you are giving with an audiogram, and if it is falling outside the speech banana. Actually this was the initial reference guideline, but now it's changed to 4K. And this is what we are giving them with a cochlear implant. So what kind of population are we catering to? We are catering to pediatric and adult population who comes from the progressive hearing loss rate. And as regards to children, it is generally prelingual or congenital perilingual. And the remedial measures we are using for these children for the therapy is known as habilitation. Whereas in adults, we are generally taking on postlingual candidates, and the remedial measures there are called rehabilitation, that is relearning of their lost auditory skills. So let us see what are the basic candidacy evaluations. There's a medical evaluation, an audiological evaluation, hearing aid trial and optimization, and psychosocial considerations. Let us now see each one in detail. As regards to the medical evaluation, now we have to realize that the auditory pathway has to be intact for the CI to function effectively. So let us go to the medical evaluations, which are generally basically as three in nature, and ENT consultation is a very important aspect of this evaluation, because most of these children are young, and they have many of these children in the age groups have middle ear diseases like SOM, serous surface otitis media, or fluid, and it may result in perforation with this. So you try to deal with these children, give them aggressive medical treatment, and if the condition still persists, then you can go on to a surgical aspect, like either do grommet with myringotomy or close their perforation in the first stage of the surgery, and then after 3 to 6 weeks you can use a CI as a second part of the therapy. Another aspect comes is that these children have, most of them are syndromic or they have other medical problems where we have to refer them to other medical specialists. Like in rubella, we have cataract problems, so refer them to an ophthalmologist. Also, they could have heart problems or cardiologist. In GRN syndrome, they have abnormal ECG, a prolonged QT interval. So we have to refer them to a cardiologist, or sometimes the reference also comes from a cardiologist because the child is not hearing well. Now, radiological assessment is most important in the assessment because most of them show cochlear abnormalities like It's not only to decide whether the IAM is normal and the cochlea is patent to insert a cochlear implant and the type of the array to be used, because we have seen from our previous experience that when the IAM is less than a certain diameter, it may indicate an absence of the auditory nerve. Also, imaging helps us to assess the middle ear function. It also gives us an idea of which ear is most suitable and also confirms the presence of a cochlear nerve. Then we go to the next slide. Most of the congenitally deaf children have radiologically detectable anomalous cochlear vestibular anatomy. And cochlear implantation does result in comparable outcomes in a Mondini disorder or ossified cochlea or a common cavity. But we have seen poorer outcomes in Steno's internal auditory canal. So MRI and CT scan needs to be routinely done. Now coming to the audiological evaluation. Aim here is to establish which ear is better or worse, that is the degree of loss, and also to know the type of deafness. An audiogram is the utmost importance in the selection process, and it requires rigorous behavioral testing. And the thresholds obtained behaviorally either through all these techniques, the BOA, the BRA, or the play or technique, or related to the age, what Deepa spoke yesterday, must be consistent. And you should not base only your evoked potential testing or electrophysiological tests to get an audiometric threshold. It is rather to help diagnose central lesions and confirm the behavioral tests, like the BERA, the OAE, and the ASSR, and in adults, the promontory stimulation. Now the impedance testing helps us to evaluate the middle ear function. Then you do hearing aid evaluation and optimization. Now the aided function helps us to monitor the function of the hearing aid, aided testing, sorry. Now what are we looking at in the hearing aid optimization? Now we are seeing children as young as 3 months, and what happens with children between the between birth and 2 years. Young children, the performance can be used, evaluated using diagnostic therapy, behavioral report, and pre-verbal tests, because very often these young children are not able to complete formal testing, standardized testing. So we have parental inventories like the IT maze or the MacArthur scales, which Anjali Khan discussed yesterday. And when there is no benefit from binaural amplification or restricted benefit, you have to refer them for a cochlear implant. Same thing for children between the age of 2 to 5 years. We have tests like testing their speech awareness threshold through the hearing aid, vowel imitation tasks, analysis of videotaped mother-child interactions, picture vocabulary test, and same when there is lack or failure to develop acceptable level of auditory skills, it is time to refer them. Between 5 and 17 years, when there is failure to develop acceptable level of language and speech, and a plateau is reached not only in the academic speech and language performance, then we can refer them. These age groups are able to complete formal standardized testing, and the test measures used are behind the early perception test. When you get a 30% or less score on the LMT or the MLMT, and 50% or less open set word central discrimination, then it's time to refer them. Now, what is the age for implantation we are looking at? FDA has approved children as young, since 1990 and as young since 2000. But nowadays we are seeing more and more children being implanted below a year. Now, age of implantation is almost accepted universally as the major variable in the outcomes with the CI. So the younger you implant, the greater the likelihood of the child achieving the highest level of auditory performance using their CI. So what age is optimal for implant is between the age of, before the age of 2 years. We all know that the critical period for language acquisition is between 0 to 7 years. Here I would like to state that even if you are implanting children below 3, what happens is there is still a language delay even if a child is operated at 2 with their normal hearing as compared to their normal hearing here because of the auditory deprivation in the first few years of life. This is a suitable period between 4 and 6. And above 7, limited benefit unless the loss is, you know, acquired or progressive. Here we will see that we have to counsel in such a way that, you know, the implant will give benefit, it will be an aid to lip reading and give a lot of environmental sound. And if they expect open speech to open set to be, you know, in their field, then it's not. So counseling is very, very important. Now, same thing with the children who are implanted between 7 and 12 years, they are following. So even for them, it's like an aid to lip reading. In teenagers also, if the child has acquired a good spoken language and a consistent hearing aid user and is motivated, we can allow. We have seen that in order to have a good benefit from the CI, you have to counsel them. As we know that prolonged auditory deprivation causes degeneration of the peripheral auditory system. Therefore, it could preclude a benefit from the CI. Now, as regards to the psychosocial consideration, now the next two slides, that is the psychosocial consideration and the informed parental input is really important part of the candidacy evaluation process, and it is to assess their involvement, the family's involvement in the selection process, extremely important to obtain successful outcomes. Not only should they accept the child's deafness, but they must be prepared for long-term commitment to habilitation and to being actively involved in the child's language development, academic progress, and to use the opportunity to let their child use the auditory skills. Also, the family must realize that the cochlear implant is not going to restore normal hearing. So, parental input is very, very important. Now, what happens is, in counseling, we should let the parents know what is the pre and post-operative procedure, what are the surgical risks, what are the benefits and limitations of the implant, answer any questions related to the CI, introduce them to different device options available, and so that at the end of the session, they should feel that CI is the way to go. When they decide that they want to have a CI, then we should allow them to meet other recipients and prepare them for lower outcomes so that they feel happy, then prepare them for outcomes that are best and then they get dejected or depressed. So why is informed parental concern a must? We have to be rigorous in our evaluation in order to give parents as much information as possible because they are the primary caretakers and they need to make the decisions for their child. Now, habilitation support. I would say that this is the most important. If you do a great surgery and mapping, but there is no habilitation support, then you have not achieved anything for the cochlear implanted child. All these other factors are discussed in the previous two slides. It's only this financial resources. The family has to realize that there is a financial aspect we have to consider, not only pre-implant, but even post-implant, like in terms of therapy. You could have money spent on the processor the accessories like the cords and the batteries. Other considerations are proximity to the clinic and other support services. Now, this is just a summary of what I have said regarding the pediatric criteria. Let us go to the adult criteria. So, same thing, there is no upper age limit referral. Restricted or more useful benefit from the hearing aid, that is a candidate obtains more than 70% in the best aided condition in the better year, but scores are less than or equal to 40% in the year to be implanted, we take him up. We have to do the speech perception and the ability must be used, not only they should be assessed not only binaurally but for each year separately using sentences in quiet, noise and non-syllables. Same thing. Audiometric thresholds in the aided range should be, the aided audiometric threshold should fall outside the 4 kHz. No central component to their hearing and realistic expectations from outcomes and commitment to habilitation. Now we are implanting even geriatrics, but they have to be counseled differently regarding expectations from a cochlear implant because they have a lot of medical considerations to be made in these patients. They have higher incidence of vestibular disturbance, central auditory considerations, central general cognitive consideration like Alzheimer's, social consideration. Now, if the patient is living a very active life, if he's still attending office, his own business or something, then he really needs his hearing to get into touch with the world, and that is why there the implant is very cost effective. But for a retired person who is just living on a meager thing, then you have to really make sure that he really requires the implant, otherwise you know. So age alone should not preclude consideration for a cochlear implant. Now when the study was done and there was no significant difference as a whole on subjective benefits between the two groups, that the younger adults and the older adults. And speech perception results in quiet for older patients were similar to the younger patients, but older patients performed poorly in noise. Now let us look what are the contraindications to a cochlear implant. Hearing loss of central origin which impedes auditory processing. Obviously, absence of cochlear nerve or auditory nerve bilaterally. Significant residual hearing, giving good benefit from traditional hearing aids. So if they have a hearing loss which is giving them good benefit from the hearing aids, not to implant. Medical risks of surgery that exceed the expected benefits of the cochlear implant. Psychological factors like severe emotional delays or behavioral problems. Now there is a condition called auditory neuropathy or dyssynchrony, which is a condition that affects neural processing of the auditory stimuli. So here a patient display characteristics consistent with normal outer hair function but dyssynchronous responses of the eighth nerve. So now it is no longer taken as a contraindication. Comparable outcomes have been noticed. In Sydney Cochlear Implant Center, there were excellent outcomes with 42 cases of AN and AN. Now there are additional issues like developmental disabilities, attention deficit hyperactive disorder, attention deficit disorder, learning disability, hyperactivity, autism, and multiple handicaps like cerebral palsy, where nowadays CI is taken up and it's giving fairly good results as per their setting good realistic expectations. Now when is CI required very urgently in cases of post meningitis, because there is rapid bone formation inside the cochlea. So serial imaging studies have to be done not only to see the ossification but also at what rate it is progressing. It also allows us to facilitate easier electrode insertion to make out what type of array is to be used, a straight or a split. In these cases, hearing aid trial period has to be shortened. Now we are looking at Usher syndrome, which is characterized by progressive deafness and blindness. So we consider cochlear implantation routinely in these cases because we are trying to give them auditory skills and so that you know they can make up for the lack of diminishing vision. Now in the West, bilateral cochlear implantation has shaped up well because they don't have so many financial constraints, and obviously because of all these advantages it has, these advantages, bilateral benefit to the head shadow, combining information with 2 years, capturing the ear with monaural, including horizontally, electrical stimulation of both ears, but your cost is very, very prohibitive. So what are we looking at now? Cost benefit of cochlear implants relative to selected medical technologies. So a cochlear implant is a life enhancing operation which gives the child, as compared to cardiac transplant, it gives the child an opportunity not only to develop speech, language and social and educational opportunity, but also to live a life of independence. Now, these are what are the expected benefits of the cochlear implant. We can say that about 0% going up to nearly 100%, just vary from awareness of environmental sounds to finally be able to talk on telephone and appreciating some music. So this answers the three questions which I put forth in my first few slides. And thank you very much for your attention. Let us focus on the message which is based on our hospital motto, Live to Live.
It was a wonderful presentation, Nishita. I'll hand over the mic to Dr. Kimpele for the next program announcement.
Any questions for Nishita? So this is really the most important top candidacy. So if you have any doubts as to any gray areas in your mind as to when you have a patient like this, should you not? Any questions?
Ma'am, I'm Ms. Shreya Ghatak doing my MASLP. I would like to ask you, I have a patient who is a post meningitis and she has a moderately severe hearing loss at present. And we have advised her a hearing aid, but is it that the hearing loss will progress and we should advise her for a CI then?
Yeah, you should keep on monitoring her hearing loss. Do hearing test and see how she's performing with the hearing aid. And at any time you feel like it's falling, then get her immediately back. And CT scan is a must. What is the status of her cochlea?
Please get a baseline
CT. Baseline CT has to be done because we want to know whether there is ossification.
Yeah? I have a question from one moment. I am Mitali Dilip from Nair Hospital. I want to ask you, can cochlear implant be done in cases with moderately severe to, moderate to moderately severe cases?
I know sometimes if they are getting a benefit from the hearing aid.
Huh?
If they are getting a good benefit from the hearing aid.
But sometimes what happens is there is no enough stimulation at home, even though we counsel the parents a lot.
The same thing will happen.
If there is no stimulation with the hearing aid, how do you expect to change that with a cochlear implant? Unless we believe in the policy that if they spend more, then
sometimes they should have.
Now I'll tell you what. We do get patients who come to us saying, we don't want to wear a hearing aid, so do a cochlear implant. They feel that once you implant something.
Yes.
But then when we show them that, look, after an implant, you still have to wear something outside.
Then they go back.
Otherwise, they feel implant means...
Nothing.
Anup, you had a question.
Kishida, you said that post-meningitis, you should have a shorter duration of hearing aid optimization. Why should there be any requirement for hearing aid trial?
No. I said that because she mentioned that sometimes they have a moderate severe hearing loss. So trial has to be given and you shorten the hearing aid period once you realize that the hearing aid is not going to benefit them. So obviously that is the criteria for candidacy. You have to give a fair hearing aid trial. But if you know that is a profound loss, that's why shorten the hearing.
But post meningitis would not be an emergency case for an implant.
It's not an emergency, it's not overnight. When you say emergency, it doesn't mean overnight.
But immediate.
Yeah, but you see the point, Anup, is that you don't want to ever get into a situation where you do an implant and somebody comes and says, why did you do an implant? A hearing aid would have worked. You say, look, we've tried a hearing aid. Waiting for a month or so is not an issue. When you say emergency, it doesn't mean that aaj meningitis ho gaya to kal operation kar do. I mean, it might be tempting to do that, but it's not to be done.
I was just saying from the point of view that ossification will now start taking.
That's right, but ossification takes a certain period of time.
Right.
The point is, if you have profound loss, then it's a different issue. But if you have some hearing left, it would be worthwhile documenting that you gave a hearing aid. It's not helping. Maybe even, you know, do speech discrimination scores and show that it is indicated. And if you can do that in the first 15 days, fine, go ahead and do the implant in 15 days.
Thank you.
Yeah, there's one, somebody had a question over there at the back.
Sir, how much importance do you give to only speech discrimination score? Suppose the patient has got moderate to severe hearing loss and his speech discrimination score is very bad. Say maybe 60 or 70.
See, if you have poor speech discrimination because the high frequencies are down, this is the classical indication for doing what you call a hybrid or a what Medel has do it. So you try, you saw the way I did the cochleostomy today, so that you try to preserve the hearing in the upper tongue, that means the low frequencies are preserved. This would be the ideal case where the low frequencies are quite good, but because the high frequency, like a ski slope, so you're not getting discrimination in spite of using the aid. This is the classical indication for electroacoustic stimulation. These are the cases.
Sir, after what time post meningitis we can consider the patient for CI?
See, post meningitis, once he has recovered, if you find immediately that there is a loss which is profound, then maybe you would try with the hearing aid, but if it's a profound loss, out and out, is completely down, then you may not wait very long, maybe a few weeks and you can do it. But if you have some hearing, then at least I would say 4 to 6 weeks with the hearing aid, see how much you can bring the patient up, what level the hearing is coming to afterwards, maybe do the speech discrimination scores, and if you show that, look, it's not helping, then you are justified in going. Look, we've had this happen to us once, that somebody came from a center, we did the implant and we were shocked, saying, why did you do the implant? It was not required. And a year later it was said, thank God you did the implant, the child is doing really better than what it was doing with the hearing aid.
So these things are giving me, but I want to know the deadline.
There is no such thing as a deadline. There is no such thing as a deadline. Even in an ossified cochlea, you could go ahead. If you have a child coming to you immediately after meningitis, monitor the child very closely, and if you find that it needs an implant, then don't wait. After you've done the adequate testing, if you say, okay, this needs an implant, then don't wait. But even if there is ossified cochlea, we've still gone ahead and done a split array. I think there somebody was mentioning to me, we did a split array, it's doing very well. Who was that who mentioned it to me yesterday? Anyway, any other questions or shall we?
Sir, yeah. Are you doing any cochlear implants in otosclerosis with SN loss, pre or post epidectomy? And how is your experience?
No, it's good. You know, in otosclerosis, again, you get ossification going into the basal tunnel of the cochlea. But there, the focus is very soft. So with a pick, right angle pick, you can literally get it out. And we have done it in autosclerotic cochlea. Also, because of the autosclerosis, they can sometimes, you might find the cochlea completely closed off. But like a meningitis, you can still go ahead and do it. You can open up the cochlea, or if required, even do a split angle.
Sir, for
because
such kind of
why I'm asking this, I have read an article which mentions that these people would still like to go ahead with a routine stapedectomy and then a cochlear implant would help much better.
No, the routine stapedectomy, unless you want to say you want to give electroacoustic stimulation for low frequencies and high frequencies.
Yes, so probably that might be.
Yeah, but that I think is really stretching it quite a bit.
Sir, for such kind of cases, shall we advise the vibrant bridge? Vibrant sound bridge.
Vibrant sound bridge, I think we have Rachna somewhere here.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. What would be the vibrant bridge range? Like if you have 4,000, 8,000 beyond 80 decibels, would you still?
No, never. No. So? Because the maximum gain which we can give is 50 dB. So the maximum output, though it is 111 dB SPL, but the gain we give is 40 to 50 dB. So we can't recommend the vibrant sound bridge.
80 dB is your cutoff point?
Even lesser than that, 80, 75 would be better.
Okay.
So exaggerated physiological jaundice series, are they
a candidate
for?
It depends upon what effect that has had on the cochlea. We've had patients with kernicterus who we've implanted. Now, there is a very logical reason for the question. Because when you say kern icterus, kern is nucleus. Therefore, it's not only the cochlea that can get affected, but even the auditory tracts can get affected. But it has been seen very clearly in these babies that the tracts do not get sufficiently affected for them to prevent a result. So the major damage would occur still in the cochlea. So we have operated on neonatal jaundice cases where the hearing went down and the results are good. Yeah, but your question is a very good question, because the term used is kern icterus, kern meaning nucleus. So it is even the auditory tracts that you get deposition of the pigment.
Implantation in bilateral
open cavity. That's no problem. Even the first stage, we have done cases where in the first stage you go down, first procedure you go down, you completely take off all the epithelium, make a nice cavity, fill it with fat, block the eustachian tube, suture the wound and suture the external auditory canal. What is that? Blind side closure, as you do for glomus tubular tumors. And 3 to 4 months down the line, you open the ear, take out the fat, do the implant, and put the fat back and close it. So you are not using the ear is totally closed. You are just using the last question, because we'll have to proceed with the next program.
Like in meningitis, you want to intervene early just to stop the progressive hearing loss. So is it the same thing to be advised in cases of Meniere's disease, where there is a progressive
You know, one thing about Meniere's disease, believe me, is that it usually doesn't go to profound loss. Meniere's very rarely goes to profound loss. People have started doing sac decompression in a unilateral case when the opposite is profoundly deaf. We never used to do that for fear of making this one deaf. Similarly, autosclerotics. One side totally deaf for whatever reason. Other side, conductive loss. We never did stapedectomy saying if this also goes, but now people are doing it because they've got something else in hand. But Meniere's per se causing profound deafness, I think I've done now about 450 plus, almost 460 cases, and I think about 300 plus we've done here, 120, 130 in Kambala Hill plus other hospitals. We've never had a patient of Meniere's disease who went for an implant. Okay, we're now going to start our crossfire round. Before that, I think I need to make some announcement, and that is for the cadaver dissection, we've got the lists. I would like to really say, and all of you who are going to do the dissection, say a big thank you to Dr. Hetal, because she has single-handedly managed. Usually it is Hetal and Milind who should do it, but Milind has now been transferred to another institute, so he's not physically present there all the time. So Hetal had the load on herself, and single-handedly, and if I may use the term, against all odds, believe me, she has managed to put this show together for us. Believe me, this time I've done absolutely nothing. Getting the microscope, drills, bones, drill bits, hand pieces, everything she's done. And we're really grateful to her for this, because without that, it would not have been possible to do this. So we're going to read out the batches. As soon as the sessions are over here, prior to lunch, batch A, no lunch. This is the privilege you get of dissecting first, no lunch. So we'll arrange lunch for you there. Now, the transport, get into a cab, we'll go together, somebody will accompany you, and you get off there. Either you can pay off the cab yourself, or whoever is with you will pay off the cab. And you have to come to the anatomy dissection hall of the CGS Medical College, which is on the second floor. Each batch is going to get 1 hour to dissect, which should be sufficient. I think we took for the entire procedure today about an... Okay, the hospital gate is open, the college gate is closed because it's a holiday today. So come in from the hospital gate and go to the college side. So as you enter, you go left. I don't think it should take you more than 1 hour to do a posterior, because the mastoid is already done, there'll be no bleeding. Posterior tympanotomy, cochleostomy, put the implant in. Should be within 1 hour we should finish. Batch A will go straight off to KM. Batch B, C and D will have lunch in. As soon as lunch is served, batch B, please allow them to have lunch first. Then they will have lunch and go there, by which time hopefully batch A will be coming towards the end of their dissection. And we will coordinate with Dr. Gauri Rajesh here, so that we'll tell them when to send the batch C and D. Okay? for the audiologists and the therapists here or the educators, you're going to have sessions on mapping, sessions, hands-on mapping. They've got all simulations. So you can do hands-on mapping. We'll be dividing into four batches. So the four companies will have their stations. You can move from station to station. Plus, they will be talking to you on auditory training, etc. So that will go on simultaneously while the surgeons are operating there. Now, we I'll tell you the batch A. Adesh, Indranath,
you're here today. The topic of my presentation would be the Harmony High Resolution Bionic Ear System from Advanced Bionics. I'd like to divide my presentation into the following four subcategories: products and accessories, technology, results, and infrastructure and support. Going to products and accessories, at the outset, this is our basic cochlear implant setup that we have. The internal part being the Hi-Res 90K cochlear implant itself, the external speech processor, which is the latest off the block, what we call as the Harmony speech processor, which is a BTE processor. And integrating both of them happens to be the most important component, which is the Soundwave software platform used for doing the mapping and the intraoperative objective measurements. Closer look at the device itself reveals a silastic casing with a titanium housing for the electronics, which is seen here. There's a three-turn gold wire coil, which acts as a telemetry coil posteriorly. There's a removable magnet, making it MRI safe. At the end, here happens to be the electrode array itself. Out here shown is the straight electrode array of ours. And as you can see, we don't have a separate ground electrode. We just have two integrated ground electrodes, one being on the case itself and the second being this metallic band out here. So the work for the surgeon becomes that much easier. He doesn't need to tunnel another ground electrode at the end of the surgery. In terms of some more surgical aspects, the profile itself is quite thin, requiring a drilling of 3 millimeters for the bed, and there's a subcutaneous prominence of maybe 2.5 mm above the bone. There's a removable magnet, like I said, and we call this the high focus electrode technology, which enables us through our flat electrode design to be able to focus the stimulation more correctly towards the nerves. The closer look at the electrode itself shows you the flat electrode plates all arranged on one side of the electrode carrier, which is silastic casing, and because of this gentle curvature, it allows a smoother insertion to take place. Snapshot of our two arrays. One is a straight array called the high focus 1J electrode, which comes with its own special insertion tool, which we'll be having a look at this evening during the temporal bone dissection. And we also have a perimodular electrode array called the Helix, the high focus Helix, which is perimodular in position and comes again with its own stillet assembly for insertion. Again, I think what is key to our product happens to be the 16 independent output circuits that we have within our electronic chip. That means we have 16 current sources within our device, giving us a lot of flexibility to the device and a lot of headroom for being able to upgrade this device without having the patient to undergo any further surgery. We call this the independent computer controlled electrode technology. In terms of the externals, I'd like to talk to you and introduce you to the Harmony BTE speech processor, which is our latest product offering. In terms of design, it retains an award-winning design of the previous generation Aurea processor, comes with the smallest, least conspicuous headpiece. It's engineered to withstand rain, sweat and moisture. Besides that, the internal electronics itself has taken a huge jump compared to the previous generation processor. It's a 16-bit processor enabling a CD quality sound for the patient. It's able to run our latest Hi-Res 120 strategy, wherein we're communicating so-called 120 channels or 120 stimulation sites to the patient. Greatly improved battery lives, jumping from 50% to over 200% compared to the previous generation processor. And an inbuilt LED for troubleshooting. Comes with various color combinations that we've designed, keeping in mind cosmetic appeal for the patient. Up to 60 color combinations are possible with our BTE speech processor. In terms of moisture performance, we have an IP47 regulation. That means we have these processors could function even after being immersed underwater for half an hour at a depth of 1 meter. It's because they have a special Xylex coating on the external, which basically channels the moisture away from the electronics, and a second conformal coating over the electronics itself, which protects the electronics from any damage from moisture. So this is the highest rating for any speech processor in the cochlear implant industry today. In terms of battery, we have rechargeable lithium-ion batteries called power cells, which come in two versions, slim and plus, providing on a full charge a whole listening day for the user. In terms of connectivity, we have various kinds of ear hooks, a ear level microphone, which provides the patient better hearing in noisy situations and is also giving some directionality, and patient can hold the phone in a more natural position like all of us. There's a direct connect which allows the patient to connect to any assistive listening device, FM systems, iPods, cable-free access via an iConnect, which is our FM ear hook, so as to say, and a standard ear hook too. Now, what's interesting is all these are also available in smaller versions. So we've specifically taken care to address our pediatric population, and we're giving them smaller ear hooks, and we are customizing this according to the patient needs. We also have a body-worn processor. The important features being, again, it comes with rechargeable batteries. It's metallic, hence making it very robust. And it comes with an integrated microphone on the headpiece. So a patient doesn't need to wear an additional ear hook as a microphone when using this particular speech processor. The microphone is integrated with the headpiece itself. For the audiologist, this is how our user interface looks on the mapping software, which we call as Soundwave, and the latest version is 1.4. Just to summarize a few quick features of that, we have 4-channel fitting, we have live speech fitting with it, there are automatic threshold settings, automatic pulse width and rate optimization, choice of 3 basic strategies of high resolution, including high-res 120, the widest input dynamic range available with cochlear implants today, and a very smart fitting and a good fast fitting, allowing the first fitting to take place in as less as 15 minutes. In terms of technology, if you look at either intensity, temporal or spectral domain, we are the market leaders today in terms of all of these three domains of cochlear implant technology. What is high-res 120? This is the latest off the block from Advanced Bionics, wherein we are able to stimulate two electrodes simultaneously and split the current in between them and move the focus of stimulation to somewhere in between the two electrodes, thereby creating additional pitch percepts for the patient. And each pitch percept can be viewed like an additional channel. And we are addressing especially hearing in noise and music for patients with this technology, and we are able to do this just because of having these independent current sources that I spoke to you about. Something like this. So as you see, once we start splitting the current, the focal point of stimulation starts moving, and hence we can have an infinite number of channels theoretically. But how do we do this? How do we reach the figure of 120? If you just look at 6 of our electrodes, although we have 16, this is just a diagram taking to 6. So we have 16 electrodes and 15 spaces in between the 16 electrodes. We're able to employ up to 8 stimulation sites between each electrode pair, hence 15 spaces times 8 gives you 120 stimulation sites across the cochlea. It's something like, you know, viewing a picture this way, or this way. So the more number of channels, we're increasing the spectral resolution for the patient, and hence, like I said, for music, for noise, these are the two areas that we are targeting with this new technology. What's interesting is more than 12,000 patients worldwide are now being able to be upgraded to this new technology on their same device without undergoing any further surgery. And a huge majority of these patients are getting a free upgrade since their processors can also handle this upgrade. So they don't need to change anything and don't need to pay us a cent for this. In terms of results, if I may just look at the results, just with the ear level microphone, patients definitely reported better hearing in either quiet, over the phone, in noise with our additional ear level microphone and compared to just the microphone of the processor itself. In terms of the number of virtual channels in our study, we could see that there were patients who could appreciate even up to 450 or 500 pitch percepts. So these patients could have somewhere up to even 500 channels. So we got a mean of around 88 channels across 61 patients, because of which we are implementing a high-res 120 strategy today. And in terms of some preliminary results from our North American studies, this is what is happening. In terms of infrastructure and support, this is we have a new structure of AB India now in Bangalore through our new clinical specialist, one of whom is here with me today, and hence we hope to improve our presence in the country and offer you better support and service. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Vinod, and thank you for sticking to the time, although you had to go at full speed, but I think you've got your point across very clearly. Thank you for that. And before I call the next person, just an announcement for the people who are going for the cadaver dissections on the way out. Please pick up your certificates. There will be a feedback form also. You pick up the feedback form. You need not fill it up just now for the people who are going to Banjing, but all the people going for dissection, please pick up your certificate, but the certificates won't be at AM, they'll be handed out here, okay? And next, we call upon the Cochlear Corporation. Who's going to speak for Cochlear?
Hi.
Again, I would like to thank the entire Visa team for this opportunity. When we talk about Cochlear, it's not just technology, it's not processing, it's about outcomes, and we'll see how are we providing these maximum outcomes. Just to know, before we go about Cochlear, what is Cochlear about? It's about around 90,000 or lakh recipients across 90 countries. It's about 1,200 to 1,700 employees across 35 countries. It's got 90 collaborative research programs across 35 countries with 200 research and development staff. So Cochlear is into research to provide maximum outcomes. Now looking at the history, it's got a long and rich history, which we see with Professor Graham Clerk's groundbreaking research in the 70s, and we are seeing developments going across until now and in the future. Looking at freedom not only provides internal, external processing and other features, it's about the outcomes again. What freedom utilizes is the CMO's internal chip. What this chip is actually doing, it's doing calculations with great precision, and all we need that is for less internal noise, sound, better sound reproduction, and as we saw this morning, for advanced NRT. But the same technology is also applied to the externals. As we see here, it's got Gore-Tex membrane, which is for water resistance, and is tested with IP44. It's got the quad DSP, that has got the capability of 8 sprints. Also, it's got the dual microphone, that is the omnidirectional as well as the directional microphone. And the splash-proof features for this processor, rechargeable batteries. And the most important key feature, it's providing pre-processing strategies. The patient gets a choice to optimize his listening in difficult or challenging listening situations. So it is providing agro, beam and whisper, and not just auto sensitivity for different listening situations. And we find that most of them prefer using this in their daily listening situations. But we need evidence that this works, and hence we depend a lot on clinical trials before we actually have our recipients use a certain processor. So we find that Freedom demonstrates outstanding performance in quiet and noise, which is demonstrated with these word scores and the HIN scores. Also we find that they prefer using lower rates. Not only with their preference, the performance also improved with lower rates. And in summary, we find Freedom recipients achieve superior outcomes faster than the previous generation systems, and they continue to show performance over time, improvement over time. But we don't stop with internals, externals, we go beyond that. Our main concern is reliability, and Cochlear will, at every 6 months, publish their reliability data. The reliability data is not only for the newer generation products, it is for the product which was launched at least 20 years ago. So we are concerned about reliability. And then quickly about what the Freedom implant does, which we used this morning. All our implants use 24 intracochlear electrodes in titanium casing. They also have, as you see in this one, it's got a gold array for stimulating the spiral ganglion. All our magnets, the magnet can be removed, it's a removable magnet. Whereas in Contour Advanced, we see there's a soft tip, there's a stilet with a marker. And what this facilitates is smooth movement through the scala and preserving structures, especially for residual hearing, minimal lateral wall forces, aid more consistent perionodular positioning, and protect delicate structures. And this is what we are concerned about. So this is what we see, that the insertion force is virtually eliminated during the advanced obstetrics. We see that we are not just into profound hearing loss and cochlear implants, it's about Baha and other technology like the hybrid that we are constantly working on. The whole thing is a patient is or people choose their implant and it's for the rest of their life. And it's about providing outcomes. But not only outcomes, but again, technology breakthroughs are available for our recipients which were implanted years ago. So what we have done is, this is Naba, who is the first recipient who got implanted 10 years ago. She is now upgraded, her internal implant is the same, and she is using Freedom
Can you see the video? I'll try and see if the video plays, but in the meanwhile, we are trying to help this entire family of recipients to see how they can get, they can also get benefited from this technology. I just don't want to run out of time.
No, we will give you that additional extra.
Okay. So this technology is for all our recipients, for this family which is growing. And we know that as the family grows, the team also needs to grow with it. So this is the PICA and the Cochlear team. We have 5 clinical specialists across India. And we have PICA, who is the distributor, wherein our colleagues help us out in the field as well. So we have a family of cochlear implant recipients, we have a team, and as we all know that cochlear implants is equivalent to a teamwork. So that is what I wanted to say, that cochlear is about outcomes. We have worked on technology, we have worked on advancements, but it's all about outcomes. So outcomes through training of audiologists, through workshops, through surgeons, and of course we can't forget the training for therapists, which is the auditory verbal therapist. I would just like to show the video in case it plays.
No, Rakhi, go back, get out of this, go to the folder. And you know, before you open the PowerPoint, in the folder you'll have the video that played from there.
In 2000, so it's almost 7 years now. Naba is now using the Freedom processor. She was initially using the Sprint processor. That was a friend, and you saw there was a lot of background noise. And now she is talking in two languages, Marathi and English, and her friend was actually teaching a Marathi. So all we are trying to do is see how a recipient can function or how we can improve their outcomes via technology. Thank you.
Any questions as yet, please write your questions and pass them on to me. Whatever you are hearing, when they talk about their product, you might have certain doubts in your mind. Please, as soon as each speaker finishes, write down questions for them. And then we'll have them all here and answer your questions. So please, I need the questions from you. The next will be, is James here? Yes. James, are you speaking for my book, right?
Yes.